Oh, that's funny.
She goes, you've got to say something. No, I'm going to ask.
I went to six restaurants.
Hello, everyone. I guess I don't need to, your energy's a little different now. No. And tonight we're doing something a little different. We're actually live streaming this, so that's a wonderful thing. Welcome. Yeah? Probably just me trying to use my night voice. There you go.
Hey, you guys.
So this is our second time meeting for our meet and greet the new thought leaders and of yesteryear, and we're also going to be doing some modern new thought as well. So tonight is a very special night because I'm going to go sit down and be in the back, and it'll be all Reverend Rita, so this is a wonderful experience for me, but I was invited to take us in with an invocation, so let's just take a moment to just breathe in. And just let this day just disappear away into this very moment, this moment called now. And what I know is that we have come here on purpose. We have come here on absolute purpose to hear what we need to hear, to say what we need to say, and to watch this wonderful Dr. Phineas Quimby unfold through the absolute energy of Reverend Rita. So I am so grateful for all of us coming together to learn more about the history, but most of all to learn more about who and what we are, and that is good, that is God, that is life. So I just say, let this evening unfold from a place of perfection. Let this evening unfold from a place of love. I am in such gratitude for each and every one of us here tonight, and I just bless Rob, who has brought this wonderful technology of live streaming so that other people can just be a part of this. So it's just all one big blessing. So I just let it go and let it be, and so it is. And it's all yours, my wonderful, intelligent, beautiful Reverend Rita.
Thank you. Oh, I see some of my Phineas Quimby students here. Did you bring your song with you?
No.
He had written a whole ballad of Phineas Quimby when he took Saints of Mine. I don't remember which class it was, but. So Phineas Quimby is very dear to my heart. Because, I don't know, I spent a lot of time with him when my dear, dear friend was very ill. And I spent a lot of time reading him and just taking in what he really actually said about disease and all these things, and brought my prayers from that place. And so, Patrick would say, you're having an affair with Phineas Quimby. And I kind of was. I would spend my nights like reading him and stuff. But anyway, so tonight is all about him. And I am grateful for the opportunity to just share with you a little bit about what he was about. There is a lot about what he was about, so much so that here's the book, and the print is very, very small. And one of the things, in case I don't get to it later, is that he did write things down, but he did never compiled anything into like a published work. He was too busy working. So people did it for him after that, and they tried to take his notes and actually make some sense of them. And there is another man, if you ever want to read him on a level that it's easier for us to understand, is Irvin Seale, wrote a book called Mingling Minds, and Phineas Quimby's Science of Health and Happiness. And he kind of condenses it down and synthesizes it a little. It's a little easier to understand, because the book is very repetitive, but in the book is all his cases and people that he healed and letters that he wrote and things like that. And it's still worth it. I mean, I open it up and I read things from it. I can't say, Rob asked me if I'd read the whole book, and I have. So I just pick things out and read it. So I want to play for you a little video. Hopefully it's going to work. Work before I try it. And it's just a little bit of, obviously, an actor reading some of his words. I thought it was a good way to start. It's called The Invitation. So the first thing to know about Phineas Quimby is he's not a religion. Nothing about him is a religion. In fact, he kind of abhorred religion to a certain extent because he felt like it was one of the culprits in man's misery and demise. So it's not a religion. And he wrote about himself, Dr. Quimby's writings are not to establish any religious creed or bolster up any belief of man, but they are simply the outpouring of a truth that sees the sick cast into prison for no other cause than a belief in the opinions of man, there to linger out a miserable existence, driven from society into the dark cells of disease where no friend is allowed to enter to soothe their woes. The knowledge of this condition is known to Quimby from their own feelings and calls forth his place in their behalf. Quimby stands to the sick as an attorney, to a criminal, a friend. So he pleads their cases and destroys their opinions, breaks the bars of death, and sets the prisoner free. This was Jesus' religion that he believed, that he taught and practiced. So he did think that the way he practiced was exactly the way Jesus practiced and was able to heal the sick. So we're going to get into all that in a minute. First, let's go back. He was born in February of 1802 in Lebanon, New Hampshire. And his father was a blacksmith, and he was the sixth of seven children, and he was called Park for short. We'll call him Dr. Crooked tonight for a little respect. His family relocated to Belfast, Maine in 1804, and he was married to Susan Harrigan, and together they had 4 children, my eyes, yeah. Well, the interesting thing about it is I don't see anything about his wife, so I don't know anything about his wife right now, but I am going to investigate that, because I just read that recently, that he was married, and yet I know nothing about his wife, so that is kind of interesting, but given that he was, very dedicated to his work, it might be not surprising that his marriage might not have been the first thing on his mind. Anyway, so let's see, what else? So he had minimal education. He followed the way of one of his brothers, William, who became a clockmaker. And he prided himself on his natural mathematical skills and being able to make things. And he had various other trades, such as goldsmith, jeweler, merchant, even photographer. And he was an inventor of at least 4 patents, one of them that was signed by Andrew Jackson. So one of the things about him that I think is really important to know about him is that he was a scientist in that he had to prove everything. He never took anybody's word for anything. If somebody said something to him, he'd say, "How do you know that?" And he would, if he saw something phenomenal or, you know, mystical or something, he had to prove it. He wouldn't just take it at the word or what he saw. He had to say, how did this happen? And he studied a lot that way. And it's all important, I think, too, to know about him that this all took place before anything, any words like subconscious and those kinds of things were used, and before psychology really came into being. And any of that stuff. This all took place. So some of the words that he used, he didn't have the words that we have today to use these things, but he was saying the same thing, which is really quite interesting to me. Let's see, what else? And then, okay, one of the important things, and we'll do this guide later on in the series. By the way, the reason we're doing this, I had to go back for a minute. The reason we're doing this at all is because these people that we're studying in this New Thought series, but the ones that came before Ernst Holmes and the Science, Mind, and Spirit were all people that influenced us and are the reason that this philosophy is in place the way it is today, is because this is our history. So it's really important to us as members of Center for Spiritual Living that we know where we came from. Just, you know, so anyway, that is important. So anyway, Anton Mesmer, okay. Does anybody know who Anton Mesmer was?
Okay.
Yes, yep. Except for it wasn't called hypnotherapy back then. It's called mesmerism. So he goes back even further. That was in 1794, and I'm just going to say a little bit about him. But he was a doctor, right? And he believed that there, like the planets and that space and all this stuff, had like energy and it was animated and it had magnetism to it and all this stuff, and he felt like he could harness that energy in these magnetic tubes and place them on people's bodies and heal them. But what he discovered when he was doing this was that, first of all, he didn't use the tubes one time and he used something else and it still worked. Then he didn't have that, and he realized that it was him that was doing it. So it was like a progression of him realizing that it was him that was creating the healing, and it was the suggestion. At one point, he went into another room and gave the suggestions, and the people were healed. So then he realized that's where the power of suggestion came from, although they didn't call it that back then. And although we like to think of him as the the person that started hypnotism, it was not really called hypnotism, it was called mesmerism, and there was somebody else that came after that. But I don't want to go too deep into that because he'll be studied at another time. But it's important to know it because when Phineas Quimby first started his work, he was a mesmerist. So that's why it's important to know what mesmerism is. And it's the idea of putting somebody into a trance and making suggestions to them and then allowing them to do whatever it is that you want them to do. He's, you know, Anton Mesmer healed some people along the way. He was called a quack and all that kind of stuff, and ended up living his life in isolation at the end, but that's another story. So anyway, Phineas Quimby, before he met mesmerism, he was actually cured by horseback riding. If anybody knows this story, he had tuberculosis. Nobody could help him in the medical profession. But a friend said to him, well, why don't you take a horseback ride up this hill? It's really good for your health, and I think it will help you. So he tried to do it, but he was so sick that he couldn't make it on the horse. So then he decided, well, maybe I could just take a carriage ride. So he ended up doing it in a carriage, and he ended up healed. He did it a few times. He went out and did this, and he was healed of his tuberculosis. And it gave him the idea that maybe, just maybe, it was the suggestion that was made that caused it to happen. That makes sense. It made sense to him. So, anyway, what happened is he went to a demonstration, because the mesmerists were big at that time, and they were doing public demonstrations and putting people in trances and healing them and making them do things and stuff like that. So he went to a demonstration and he got really, really interested in it. He thought, this is very interesting. I want to know more about this. So what happened is he started to experiment with mesmerism. And he called it the action of mind upon mind. Mind upon mind. He didn't call it the power of suggestion. He called it the power of mind upon mind. And he would put people into trance. Well, he started with Lucius Bookmar, who we want to go to first. He would put people into, he would put Lucius into a trance, and Lucius would diagnose people's diseases and give a remedy of a cure. And it became like a phenomenal thing. They would go to places, and I tell you, they were mob violence and all this stuff going on then, because people thought they were crazy and crackpots and all that kind of stuff, right? But as a mesmerist, he diagnosed disease by means of the subject in a trance or a mesmeric state. And he collaborated with clairvoyant Lucius Bookmar, who could fall into a trance and diagnose the illnesses. And then the medicines that were prescribed by Bookmar with no physical value cured patients of diseases. Now, he tells an interesting story which led him to his next discovery, which was that he was working with this doctor, this patient, and Lucius said that the patient should take this tea and he would be healed. And so what he found out, because the doctor was there, was that the doctor, and he didn't know this, okay, the doctor had prescribed the same exact tea and the patient wasn't healed, okay, but the patient took the tea and he was healed, so, which is kind of interesting, right? Well, what Phineas, this is really great, he said what he figured from the whole thing, that maybe it was more influential to have a person in a trance tell this person that he needed to take this tea and he would be healed than it was to have a doctor say it to him live in person. But he was healed by the thing. So there it was again. He was able to, he just kept investigating this more and more. What is going on? Mind upon mind. The other thing he was able to do too was they would go and do surgeries with the doctors. They would go in and they would put the patient in a mesmeric state, and they were able to do, they had no anesthesia in those days, they were able to remove tumors and do all this stuff without anesthesia, and the person didn't feel any pain, and they were cured. So it was all, you're going to be like, that's really weird.
Yeah. I thought the cancer, tumors started earlier, not
You know, they had everything in those days. They just didn't know. They didn't know what it was. They probably didn't call it that. Okay, they didn't call it cancer. They didn't know what it was. They just knew the person didn't feel good. So, anyway, this is all in his mesmeric days. Okay, I want to make sure I get this correct because it's really important. I want to make sure I tell you this. Okay, I told you the tea story. That one is really important. The other thing he realized was that he didn't have to talk in order to get the person to hear him. One day he was with Lucius and he got the idea that he was going to go for a walk. No, he was going to leave the room. Lucius was in a trance and he was going to leave the room. And as soon as he got the thought that he was going to leave the room, Lucius got up and got in his hat. And he didn't say anything. He just got his hat. And then in his mind, he said, I'm not going to leave him. And Lucius took the hat and put it back on the table. So it was this idea that he could actually talk to people without saying words. And he came up with the conclusion that basically that we all lived in this one mind and that we were influencing each other for good or for bad. Okay? And that he didn't call the subjective mind, but the mind, this mind that there was two minds, was amenable to suggestion. And he found that his thoughts were one thing and his beliefs were another. If he really believed something, the effect would follow whether he was thinking it or not. So that there was another level below that was belief, even below like what he was suggesting. If he didn't believe it, then it didn't happen. So, so the hat story. Then there was a lemon story. That one was a good one too, with Lucius. And no words again. No lemon. He found that he could create things in the mind that weren't there just by thinking of them. And apparently Lucius had this horrible habit of sucking on lemons. I don't know. He liked to suck on lemons. I don't know why his horrible habit, but they both thought it was. So he put Lucius into a trance. He had no real lemons. But he kept feeding him lemons, mentally, until he got so sick of the lemons, he didn't want them anymore. Like I said, he kept doing these experiments just to see where it would take him. And then at one point, he said, like, he would tell somebody mentally to go sit in a chair. Like I would say, Harry, go sit. And Harry's in a trance, and I would say, Harry, go sit in that chair, and I would point to the chair that Jesse's sitting in, and Harry would go sit in the chair and sit on top of Jesse, not knowing he was there. Okay? Yeah. Crazy, right? So this was all his experimentations. And I think he got tired of it after a while because he wanted to do something more. He found that... So what he concluded from all this is that a lot of this had to do with belief. And that the beliefs was what was causing people to do what they were doing, and that there was something called belief that was generating the action behind everything and the cures and all of that. So he realized that there were two levels to mind. That our thoughts were active in the upper level, and that below that were our beliefs, and that they had a life of their own. Our beliefs had a life of their own, and in reality, we were acting out our life from our beliefs. But he also realized, with the lemon story and a bunch of other things that he did, that our beliefs could be changed. They definitely could be changed. And that was like a very important thing that he realized, that they could be changed. Because if your beliefs can be changed, then you can change what? Anything, right? What he realized was that everything that was happening to people was happening because of their beliefs and because someone had told them something and that created whatever it was. But in reality, all there really was spirit. all there really was basically a blank slate, and our whole lives and everything was created by what we believed. This is why he was so against like religion and dogma and stuff like that, because it felt like it made people sick, because people would feel, you know, guilty about things and bad about things, and then they would create these atmospheres within their bodies that would just turn into something real, not real, we called it a shadow, because of what they believed, or because of what somebody told them. If a doctor told somebody that they had something, then that would generate even more terror or more upset and name it something, and then it gets even worse, and pretty soon one thing is happening to another, and then you're really sick or you're dying or something. This was all him, and this is what he believed, this is what he set out to prove. And he did it all through experimentation. He also realized that the lower mind, that subconscious mind, that what we call the subconscious now, took orders. It could take orders without any, it's what we call the law of our being, the subconscious, whatever you want to call it, that place that dwells, that just takes orders, it's impersonal. It made the person walk, made Harry walk over and sit in the chair and sit on top of Jesse just because it believed it could do it, and it didn't know that Jesse was there. So it was this idea that it took orders without any kind of reasoning behind it. So, okay, so next. So he ended up believing mesmerism because he felt like there were some spiritual laws that were behind all this that he really wanted to delve into, and he didn't feel like he needed to put people in trances. He didn't feel like he needed Lucius anymore. He actually became a clairvoyant himself. And when we use the word clairvoyant, I guess it's the same way we use it today. It's somebody that's in total empathy with someone else who can actually pick up the feelings and all that of another person. So he became a clairvoyant himself. And he says, like, basically, we're all clairvoyants, we're all mediums, we're all those things. We just don't use them, but we are all those things. Because we all have that capability, because we're all living in one mind. That is the whole thing. That any kind of knowledge, like, I told myself that tonight when I was like, oh my God, am I going to get all this information across? But in reality, I already have all the information. All I have to do is open up to it, and it's there for me. Thomas Troward said the same thing when he was studying for a metaphysical exam, and he felt like he didn't know the material. That one night he just went into meditation and said, you know what? Infinite wisdom, infinite knowledge is everything that there is, so therefore it's my knowledge too, because I live and breathe in that one mind and that one power, and therefore I already know this. And so he went and he aced the test, and the teacher said to him, you know, how did you do that? And he said, you're brilliant. And he said, yeah, I am, right? So anyway, so he also said, man has the power to create ideas and make them so dense that they can be seen, or to reverse this process and cause them to disappear. It is the truth that heals, and the individual mind that perceives and holds to truth will be in health and good order and reflect that health and good order to others. So at one point, he was able to materialize, not by speaking, by thinking about a lion to Lucius, to the point that that lion became so real to Lucius that he freaked out and thought it was really there, and then he was able to make it disappear. So he's saying the same thing. Man has the power to create ideas and make them so dense that they can be seen, or to reverse that process and cause them to disappear. So he's saying the same thing about illness, that if we believe in it to that point, that we are actually making it grow, making it appear greater and greater, because it's becoming more and more real to us. This was his philosophy. And that it was the truth that healed, because he started to become more inclined toward the Jesus' teachings and the Bible and how did Jesus heal, and the metaphorical ideas in the Bible. Like he said, people were interpreting the Bible the wrong way, that this is what it was really meant. meant the two worlds were not the, a world up here in heaven. It was the two worlds being the natural world of man and the world, the spirit world, which is the world of unlimited possibilities, perfection, and all of that. So he said the truth of that is what would heal the individual mind. The perceived and holds to the truth will be in health and good order and reflect that health and good order to others. So that's where he tried to bring himself, was to that place where he could not think anything but truth and goodness and perfection, because he believed that there couldn't be a God, he said, that would want suffering for people. That does not make any sense. It didn't make any sense to him that suffering was something that was God ordained, but that the truth was that it was love and it was perfection. He called it science and wisdom and all those things, and there was science and error. Wisdom and error. He used those words interchangeably. So he said the disease was an error in the mind. Now, he did not say it was in the imagination. It's a really important thing, because he didn't say people weren't in pain. Like if somebody came to him and they were in horrible pain, he didn't say you're not having pain. The same as we do as practitioners. We don't tell somebody, no, you're not really sick. It's in your imagination. That's different. What he was saying was that it started in a belief and in the mind and in an opinion, and then it became real and condensed itself to physicality, if that makes sense. So he would get to the idea behind whatever it was. He went into this healing practice without trances or spiritualism. I'm going to explain what he meant by spiritualism from 1959 on. So in other words, and I already told you he became a clairvoyant and the truth is the cure. So people accused him of being a spiritualist. And back in those days, a spiritualist was somebody who spoke to the dead and had the dead speak through them and all of that. And he didn't believe in that. There was this thing going on at that time called the New Hampshire Rappings or something Rappings. I can't remember what they're called. It was a group, it was a movement where people had had seances, kind of, I guess, and there were mediums. And people would talk to the dead would come and they would, you know, they do that today too, right? But what his belief about all that was that the people were reading what was going on in the minds of the people there, and they were really good at it. So if I come to you and I say, tell me about my brother, and you don't know my brother at all, but in my mind, in that place that he talked about, that's the subconscious, that's the place that doesn't necessarily consciously speak it, but it's still there, and I'm in that same mind as you, he could pick up a good medium or medium, I guess, could pick up anything that the person was thinking. And he conducted a lot of experiments to prove that, and he did prove it. I mean, in his own mind, in his own way, he proved that. In his way, because that's what he thought. Because he didn't think anybody was really dead. I'll tell you what he said about his own death at the end. Because he thought there's that part of us, that part that can travel from place to place when we dream, and that part of us that, you know, could go and be with someone that, which he did some of this experience, go back to a time when we weren't supposedly alive. He believed that that part never died. That part was still was here. It was always here. It never could leave. So he didn't really actually believe anyone was dead, which is really interesting too. I love that. That we weren't going to die, and that we were really alive, and that we were just basically in a different place. But we're all in touch with everything because we're all in that one space, in that one mind, in that one amazing thing. I mean, this is really, like, when you think about what time he lived, like in those times, right? And these people, like even Anton Mesmer, all of these people that we're going to be studying, that were the way showers for all of us, went back. And now, you know, and now we're acting like it's all new, but it really isn't new. I feel like we're in the middle of a renaissance, that it's all coming now into the foreground because we're needing it for this planet, right? So it's like, oh, okay, well, this is not, I mean, Socrates was saying some of these things too, right? And Plato and people like that. So it's not new. Okay, so I have another little thing for you. This one is more, this is his writing about how he cured. And then I'll read you something else about it. So hopefully it's gonna work. I know it is. Treating my way through this. little screen. Why does it do that?
Every phenomenon in the natural world has its birth in the spiritual world. Of this truth, however, men are ignorant, and mistaking shadow for substance, they give credit when credit is not due. No man, for example, should be considered superior to another unless he proves his superiority by reducing to a science some phenomenon hitherto unexplained. Before musical sounds were reduced to a science, they were simply phenomena. People could sing, but he who sang best was not entitled to more praise than any other, for he sang ignorantly. To him only was credit due who reduced musical sounds to a science. The same is true with regard to disease and its cure. The world is full of sickness arising from various causes. The phenomena are in the natural world, while the causes originate in an invisible world. Medical science, being based on opinions, is confined to the natural world, where the causes of disease are supposed to arise. This is not the case with the science by which I cure. By a clairvoyant faculty, I obtain a knowledge of disease which cannot be obtained through the natural senses. This being imparted to the patient changes the direction of his mind and affects the cure. In other words, the explanation of the disease is its cure. I will state a case for illustration. A person calls on me for examination. We sit down together. No questions are asked on either side. I have no knowledge of the patient's feelings through my natural senses. After placing my mind upon him, I become perfectly passive, and the patient's mind, being troubled, puts me in a clairvoyant state. As I retain my natural senses, I am, it is evident, in two states at once. The history of his trouble, together with the name of his disease, I now relate to the patient. This constitutes the disease, and the evidences in the body are the effect of his belief. Disease, according to my theory, does not reach to the natural senses. I cannot, therefore, explain to the well my mode of treatment. The well take no interest in it, for to them my theory is of no use. Then of what use, it may be asked, is it to the sick? It gives the sick such confidence in themselves that they are not frightened by opinions of disease, for disease itself is an impudent opinion. Guided by it, I throw off the feelings of the sick and impart to mind my own, which are those of perfect health. The explanation I make destroys their disease. I am to the sick as a captain to his crew. When storms arise, dangers thicken, and destruction seems inevitable. He understands his business, has confidence in himself, inspires the crew with his own spirit, and finally brings the ship safe into port.
Somebody gets news that their person, somebody they knew was killed in a train, a plane crash, or something like that. Not a plane crash back in those days, but a train crash.
They start to become empathetic to that. They start to become nervous and upset, and all of a sudden they start to become sick. And then they find out that it's not true. And then all of a sudden they're not sick anymore. I mean, how many times do you go, like, you call the doctor to say you're coming, and then all of a sudden you feel well because you're now going to the doctor, right? It happens, right? So, anyway, so he was said to have healed like 500 people for approximately 15 years, probably through the mesmerism technique and through his own, the one he finally developed. And he believed that the two big enemies of wisdom are God, were priests, and doctors. I'm sorry for any priests out there. But he really did have kind of a, like, mostly because they made him feel guilty and because they were saying things. And back in those days, think about, I don't know how the religions are now, but back in those days, they were pretty like hellfire and damnation type of thing. And, you know, you're going to be sick because you don't believe in God and stuff like that, or you don't do what God says and stuff like that. That's the kind of things they were telling people back then. I mean, even Ernest Holmes, his parents had to re-talk him when he came home from church to tell him that he wasn't a worm of the dust. That he was a child of God, that he was perfect and whole and complete. So that's probably why he didn't like, you know, that kind of thing. In fact, I'm going to read you a little story because, do I have time? Yeah, I've got plenty of time. Because I think it's good if I can find it. And I can read it better than I could probably if hopefully I can find it, because I said 125. I don't know. I didn't want to print the whole thing, but anyway, now I can't find it. It was about a Calvinist lady who had an idea that basically that Jesus had gone away, and that she couldn't be with that power, and so she was making herself sick over it. And he explained to her that was not true, that Jesus was right where she was. And loved her and blah, 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 blah. And she got it. And she became well. I don't know what was wrong with her. I'm sorry, I can't find it. But I'll find it later. And I'll send you. Buy the book and read it. Anyway, but, I mean, he has millions of stories like that. So basically, so he healed over 500 people a year for approximately 15 years. And then about the priests and the doctors. And the same reason with the doctors, that he believed that... They were telling people things that possibly were just opinions. They were opinions, and they were making them so real. And he knew if he could change man's beliefs to truth, he could cure him. And this is the way he did it, just the way he said in that thing that we just listened to. And he didn't put people in mesmeric sleeps. He just sat with them and read their thoughts, basically, and then talked to them. So... Yeah. I lost my script because I have so much I want to say, but I can't say it all. Okay, so here's another thing he said. This is good, too. I'll just read this to you because I have time. A patient comes to see Dr. Quimby. This is another way of saying it. He, Dr. Quimby, he's writing this, renders himself absent to everything but the impression of the patient's feelings. These are quickly... daguerreotyped, or I guess like a camera, on him. They contain no intelligence, but they're a shadow forth of a reflection of themselves, which he looks at. This contains the disease as it appears to the patient. Being confident that it is a shadow or of a false idea, he is not afraid of it, but he laughs at it. Well, I'm sure he didn't laugh out loud, but in his own self, he laughed at it. Then his feelings in regard to the disease, which are health and strength, are daguerreotyped back onto the receptive plate of the patient, which also throws forth the shadow. The patient, seeing the shadow of the disease in a new light, gains confidence. This change of feeling is daguerreotyped on the doctor again, and this new impression also throws forth a shadow, and he sees the change and continues to treat it in the same way. So the patient's feeling sympathizes with his, and the shadow grows dim, and finally light takes its place, and there is nothing left of the disease. And, yeah. So he, like, he compared himself to Jesus because he said, compare himself, not himself, but his way of doing it. He said, it's just like when the centurion said to the, Jesus said to the centurion, go thy way, as thou hast believed, so it has been done unto thee. And the servant was healed in the same self hour. And when he closed his practice in 1965, he was going to write everything down, but he never made it to that. But
I think 1865.
Yeah, 1866 is when he passed. 1865. Did I say 19?
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I don't know why I'm in 19th century, 20th century, but for some reason I am. 1865. Thank you for catching me. So he said, I'm more than ever convinced of the truth of my theory. I am perfectly willing for the change myself. He was talking about death. But I know that I shall be right here with you, just the same as I have always been. I do not dread the change any more than if I were going on a trip to Philadelphia. So now let me tell you about how he died, because you could look at his years. He was born in 1802 and he died in 1866. According to his family, his son, he overworked himself. In fact, sometimes his son would have to come and take him and bring him home, because he would get so involved with what he was doing, he would actually start to take on the stuff. And at one point he went into some kind of frenzy with somebody that was kind of crazy type of thing, you know, and started taking it on, almost passed out, and his son had to come get him. So I suspect, from what I read about him, and you know, 500 patients a year that he healed, and probably maybe not everybody maybe that came to him was healed, but 500 a year were healed, so can you imagine how many he was seeing, probably. And he also did it through writing letters to people, so he did absent treatment, what we call absent treatment, because he, if somebody couldn't get to him, like was in a far off place, they would write a letter, and he would say, you know, I'm going to be with you at this hour, let's sit together, and they would sit together in different places, and he would do the same thing with them. So, I mean, he was probably constantly working, that's what we have about his life, he was constantly working. So he basically worked himself to death. That's what his family said. Because he worked so hard, and he was probably so obsessed with what he was doing that but he didn't care, because he really loved what he was doing, and he just couldn't stop because he wanted to prove it. And he wanted to get it all written down, but what they said about him was that he was so particular of how it was written down, like that people couldn't take notes from him, like, very well. Because he wanted to repeat things over and over. He said it wasn't bad to repeat things. It was okay because people would get it better if it was repeated over and over. So he must have been, you know, it must have been hard to work with him as a whatever they were back in those days, like taking notes from people. But so he never really had the opportunity to actually get it all written down. But other people did it for him. And therefore is that book. He had it written down, but it was like, can you imagine a bunch, you saw some of the scribblings before, a bunch of notes that people were trying to take. So, let's see. So he died in 1866, and this is what they said about him. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Right? For if ever a man did lay down his life for others, that man was Phineas Parkhurst, quickly. So, I'm doing good. Yeah, so much done. So he became the father of new thought because he discovered that belief alone makes sick, and it is a belief alone that heals. And he spent the last years of his life in healing work through mental means only, and he became known as the father of new thought in America. So this is where our roots go back to, is to him. Because that is what our whole faith is based on, is that it's done unto you as you believe. I mean, if we had to put our faith in simple terms, that's what we would be saying. It's done unto you as you believe. And these were the teachings that were put together by these, like, kind of summarized his teachings. And we'll just go through them. The omnipresent wisdom, the warm, loving father of us all, creator of the universe, whose works are good, whose substance is an invisible reality. So that is it. The omnipresent wisdom, God, whatever you want to call it, that energy of the universe is all that there is, and it is an invisible thing. The real man, whose life is eternal, in the invisible kingdom of God, whose senses are spiritual and function independently of matter. So, in other words, there's spirit, and it functions independently of matter. It's functioning whether matter's there or not. And spirit and matter are one thing, really, but only because of spirit. The visible world, which Dr. Quimby once characterized as the shadow of wisdom's amusements, that is, nature is only the outward projection or manifestation of an inward activity far more and real enduring. So everything that is happening, everything that we're seeing, everything that we're experiencing is coming from the spirit, basically, and it's the shadow picture thereof, and changeable. Spiritual matter or fine interpenetrating substance directly responsive to thought and subconsciously embodied in the flesh, the fears, beliefs, hopes, errors, and joys of the mind. So everything spiritual becomes physical. Whether it's fears, beliefs, hopes, errors, joys of the mind, it's just all coming forth that way. Disease is due to false reasoning in regard to sensations, which man unwittingly develops by impressing wrong thoughts and mental pictures upon the subconscious spiritual matter. So it all starts in spirit, nowhere else. As disease is due to false reasoning, so health is due to the knowledge of the truth. To remove disease permanently, it is necessary to know the cause. You can turn the page, didn't I? Thank you.
Oh!
God. Getting better at this, but you know what? I got it. Go. Okay. At least I know how to fix it right. Okay. Disease is due to false reasoning in regard to sensations, which man unwittingly develops by impressing wrong thoughts and mental pictures upon the subconscious spiritual matter. As disease is due to false reasoning, so health is due to the knowledge of the truth. To remove disease permanently is necessary to know the cause, the error which led to it. That's what he would do as patients. His whole laptop log line is, you know, is the explanation is cure. As soon as they would get it, then they would be cured. As soon as they saw the reasoning behind it, they would be cured. As soon as they saw the ridiculousness of it, whatever it was that caused it to begin with, they would be cured. And so when he said, "Thy faith thou shall make you whole," he didn't mean like faith, like belief. Faith meant understanding. Your faith is making you whole. Your faith is healing you because you're getting it and you're embodying it. So I thought that was an interesting definition of faith. To know the truth about life is therefore the sovereign remedy of all ills, the truth Jesus came to declare. Jesus knew how he cured, and Dr. Quimby, without taking any credit to himself as a discoverer, believed that he understood and practiced the same great truth or science. Really, a lot of stuff, right? So what does this mean to us in religious science? Well, like I said, our whole philosophy is based on if we change the way we think and believe, that we change our life. And this is the whole basis of our practitioner studies, is to bring ourselves to a point where when we sit with somebody, we actually can get what they're saying, not by what they're saying necessarily, but what they're not saying. We get to like sit with somebody and understand that when they're saying certain things, they're coming from someplace else. There's a belief in there. And our job as practitioners is to separate that belief from the believer. So it's very similar, kind of, to what he did. And also in that he did it within himself. Like he brought himself to the truth, and then the patient was receptive, so the patient received the truth. So this is what I believe that we got from Phineas Quimby. So from the standpoint of the spiritual man, disease, poverty, unhappiness, and misery are neither person, place, nor thing. So that's what our whole practitioner work is about. So yeah, it's a lot. I hope I haven't confused you. It's not, it's pretty simple, right? I was like, it's just like so much information. I was so like wanting to get it down so I would be able to tell you in the right amount of time. Because, I mean, really, Phineas Quimby probably could be like a college course for, you know, a whole semester and more. And there are people that practice, I think they're called medical intuitives. And I actually looked them up in California, and I tried to like, to get with one, but I never could get her to return my calls. But I remember we were going to go see her because they profess that they do, that they use the same treatment as Phidias Quimby. So, but as far as anybody else that actually does that, other than what I told you about practitioners, I don't know if that. Oh, you know who I didn't mention was Mary Baker Eddy, because she's somebody we'll do on another time. Liana asked me about it. Mary Baker Eddy was a patient of Phidias Quimby and was healed by her. And she went on to create what we know as Christian Science, right? And there was a big like controversy because she at one time denied that she actually was even healed by him and that everything she had was really original and that it was her thing and not his. And there was a big controversy, but I think they finally settled it. And when we do make her Mary Baker Eddy, we'll go more into that. But it's good. So these are some of his quotes. And I'm just going to read them, and we can talk about them if you want. For we are mere machines regulated by wisdom and opinion. The world of opinions is the old world. The world of science is the new world. I never make war with medicine, but with opinions. The world is a state of mind where man creates whatever he understands from what he hears and sees. There is no intelligence in anything that can be seen by the eye. One can only see the working of intelligence in matter. Cease from arguing about what you do not understand until you learn what you are talking about. That's my favorite one. Because, go try to prove it. How can you go argue about something you never even tried to prove, right? And you're arguing with somebody that already proved it. Man has analyzed everything but himself, which to himself is a complete wilderness. How many often have we been told that by the great philosophers and mystics of the ages? Know thyself, right? Know thyself. Priests and physicians, these men stand to society as a mesmerizer to his subject. So yes, see, so he believed they were kind of mesmerizing people, putting suggestions in their mind. And he felt like, it was going to really help people, and he did. He helped a lot of people. So, and I'm sure he still is helping people because I believe this, he believes, and he's still here. And he's coming through other people that are doing the same thing, his wisdom and his knowledge, and there's new people birthing all the time. Look at us in this room. It never stops, and we're growing, and we're expanding, even what he's done, with quantum physics and all these things. And, the placebo effect is a big thing, right? And now we're saying that, you can change your cells even. So, and what is that? That's Phidias Quimby. You can change your own cells by how you believe and how you think. People think they're subject to their heredity, and they're not subject to their heredity, except for by their belief. Of course, maybe there's some kind of tendency, but I believe that the tendency is only what we make it, and then they're proving that now. Bruce Lipton, all these people, they're saying no. These are doctors. What's his name? One I like so much, Deepak Chopra. All those people that are in the medical profession that are actually now saying what these guys were saying for centuries and centuries and centuries, and actually proving it the other way around. So, I guess I'm open for questions, or we can discuss some of these points, or we can talk about anything we want to. Questions, I guess, if you have any. Last time we rushed through it so much that we didn't have time for questions or interesting things or thoughts that we had on all this. And so, and before we leave, I'm going to play that one thing again. I love that one. God or wisdom, I told you that before, has never made anything to torment mankind. And to believe a thing is to make it. To know that you exist is nothing. I love this one. But to know what disturbs you is of great value to everyone. It's true, right? If you know what disturbs you, you're going to be able to get to the root of whatever that is. And you're going to... Everybody else is going to be better off, right? To teach is to adapt a language that will convey a principle to another. This is what I am trying to do. Yeah, it was really important to him to try to get it in print, and he wanted to get it so people could do it. And he never did get to that point, but it doesn't mean we can't now. And we are. So, what else? No questions? Did I stun you that much?
I have a question.
Yeah, good. I hope I can answer it.
I may have been mesmerized and missed it, but did you talk about how he believed that Mama had died?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
No, it's okay. He didn't believe anybody was dead. That's why we were all living in one mind. We just might not be in this consciousness.
What kind of experiment?
What kind of experiment? Well, the one with the spiritualist, because he felt like, what kind of experience? No, that wasn't the one. I don't know. There's a whole passage on it. I think it was because he felt that because there was this part of us that continued to live in dreams and things like that, what was that part of us? And it didn't stop living, obviously, or otherwise it wouldn't be able to go from place to place and experience something back, you know, 200 years ago or 20 years ago, and then come back to this time, or where do we go in dreams, those kind of things, I think. I mean, he didn't see ghosts or anything like that. At least he never said he didn't. In fact, he was really, like, against that part of it. Like, not against it, but he didn't want to make it mysterious. He felt like it was fact. That there was a part of us that could travel anywhere. And what was that part? It wasn't our brain. Like, our brain died when we were gone from here. Our brain no longer functioned. But the mind continued to function. Or we wouldn't be able to tap in to everything that from ages ago and stuff like that if it wasn't all still alive. That's the way I understood it.
The soul lives on.
The soul lives on, right. Their soul is the thing that lives on forever. The consciousness, the soul, whatever you want to call it. It's eternal. He said he wasn't even afraid of his own death. He didn't believe he was dead. He didn't believe that. It's a belief, exactly. And he did say that. He said the death was a belief. We believed it, so we made it real to ourselves. But in reality, we could all be like dead right now. We're still alive, right? We don't know. There's a mystery to life that we don't know. There is a mystery to life that we don't necessarily know. But the more we open up, I believe, the more we do know. But we can't comprehend things, you know, the mysteries of life until we understand what's happening right here and right now. I think sometimes we want to throw ourselves too far. Like, it's like the teachings of Jesus. Like, Jesus spoke in parables, right? And people didn't really understand what he was saying because they weren't thinking from his mind. If you, like Ernest Holmes said, that if you could think from the mind of the great master Jesus, then you would understand more of what he was saying. But we're trying, with our finite minds, you know, trying to figure out things that are eternal verities that we will, and we do, and we can tell ourselves that we do, and we can open up to more. That's what this philosophy is all about, is opening up to more divine influx, to more expanding ourselves. But it's like walking on water. Who cares if I can walk on water? Can I live my life now? Someday maybe I will be able to walk on water, but it's not that important, right? Yes?
Yeah, I know. It's just kind of a comment on this, that everyone's looking for so much new stuff. It's like, what's the new thing? What's the new
kind of weekend. Yeah, this tonight it's actually made me see. We went through in stereo, so we absolutely, I know Quimby, but it was made me think we keep wanting the next thing before we even develop the thing that we are. And that's what I'm seeing here. If they're talking about this long before Quimby was, then why don't we just take what we know? And that's why I love Science of Mind and Spirit, is because why don't we take what we are and use that, because we have it all at our fingertips. But I think we get impatient with the idea, okay, I got to get to the next, I just read another book, and this book told me that. And then I went to see another person, and they told me that. And then I went to another person, and I feel that we might be, it's just Patrick's personal belief, that we might be distracting ourselves from the real cure that's already present. But if we keep looking and keep finding, and I'm not saying I'm into four books right now, but I'm saying that I think there's something here, because what I'm hearing tonight, Rita, that you're saying, is no different than the absolute, you know, practitioner of the cures that we're doing in the science. And then one other little point I was telling Ron tonight, I said, it's interesting that we have it all, but it's kind of a lonely feeling. Because if it does depend on our belief, and at the end of the day, I believe it does, then it feels lonely at times because the responsibility ends up back here. And so it's much better to gather and say, oh yeah, me too, and what about you, and how about you, and how about you? And then at the end of the day, oh, know thyself. Oh, I'm the final denominator. It is all about me. And yet we get help and we get, you know, assistance. So anyway, that's a very interesting thing that I'm learning. So I'm thinking, wow, why don't we just kind of go with what we know, not just this quantum, any of it, and keep wanting the next thing. So interesting.
Well, until we can embody it, it can only be to us what we can understand and embody and bring forth into our lives. It can only be to us what we prove. We have to prove it to ourselves, really, basically. Yes, you want to say something?
Like what Patrick was saying, and I've been seeing an acupuncturist every week. And every time I go to this acupuncturist, even though I believe the theory is that it's going to make me better, I feel terrible and I spend all day in bed and depressed, which is what I did yesterday. And I was like, why do I keep running from healer to healer? When maybe what I just need to do is just sit in the stillness and go into that inner deep place and just do it myself. But it seems so much easier to just say, somebody fix me.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And not that I haven't done that, but it's just a piece of it. And, you know, I was thinking about this. What I gathered, my interpretation from his theory, is that we are energy beings and that form follows energy. So basically, we're kind of creating this channel of energy through our beliefs. This is what we believe, then our physical body kind of follows that. It gets stuck in this groove. So the thing to do is to shift the energetic pattern. Mm-hmm. But in my experience, the physical form is much slower to change than the energetic pattern. So what I'm wondering from your studies of him is, are the people being healed instantly?
Some of them. He said, I don't know every case, but
if they got it, if they got what he was saying, if they, their faith had made them whole, if they got the understanding and the realization of what he was saying, then yes, right then. And maybe he had to meet with them more than once. In fact, he wouldn't even take money from people unless he would say, you know, send me the money when, and it was so little, like $2 or something for a session. It was, but then back in those days, maybe that was a lot of money. But he wasn't after money or any of that. But he would say, don't until I get, you tell me that you're healed. So he could probably sit with people more than once, I'm sure. But it was instantaneous. It wasn't like they went home. He sat with them until they got it, until they could feel what he was putting over to them. There was something else I was going to say about it. Oh, he said something about, we come here like a blank slate, was pure babies, right? And then all of a sudden, layer upon layer, we're given beliefs of our parents, of those that we, you know, teach us, our friends, and then pretty soon we're believing everything and we're growing into these people that's all belief. It's all belief. So it makes sense, like he said, that we created disease basically and made it so real that it is real. There's no doubt that it's real. We all know people that are sick. We've been sick ourselves, right? So, yeah, we made it real, but the point is that it has to start in the mind, not because you did something bad or anything, because you got a wrong idea about something or somebody something, and that's where you have to start with it. And I know for the times of myself when I've been sick, the times that I've been able to heal is the times when I go back to loving myself, when I go back to that pure state that says, you know, I'm whole. I'm a child of God. I'm a peaceful state. And then I don't concentrate on getting rid of the thing that's wrong with me. I just concentrate on feeling that oneness with spirit. And then maybe that's the same thing. It's the same thing he's talking about. And you can. And eventually it has to happen within you. You can't, like, somebody can't do it to you. They had to finally get the understanding, right? So I love this thing, and I think it's so important. For 20 years, I have never said one word to a patient which, if you believe, would make him worse or cause him one moment's pain or misery. I have tried it, and I know that the principle is right. Never to say to a person anything that will, if believed, make him the least disappointed or grieved. If you cannot leave a happy impression, do not leave a bad one. So it's kind of a thumper. If you can't say something nice, don't say anything at all. Long-winded version of that. But I think that's so true because we are susceptible to suggestion. And we are. I mean, haven't you ever had somebody say something to you, like, you know, or, and you're like, all of a sudden, wow. Yeah, like I've had people say, you look really tired. And I'm like, I don't feel tired. I really look tired, okay? I mean, why would somebody come up to you and tell you to look tired? I mean, come on. And thank you for telling me I look beautiful tonight. I appreciate it. And yeah, because it is true. I mean, eventually you got to do it yourself, but it's nice to get the positive encouragement, right? Yes, you want to say something?
Oh, Patrick's pointing to somebody.
Oh, Tom. Oh, over here, and then Tommy.
I was just going to say that this is almost like a parallel of Edgar Cayce's life. Of Edgar Cayce's
death.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's almost like it was a incarnation. That's very detailed. But this, anyway, his mind is the builder.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah.
And also...
You're talking to it so that all the pieces want to pick you up on the lifespan.
And he also died a little young, I think 60s or 70s, of exhaustion. Because
right.
He worked so much.
Right.
So
right.
It's interesting.
Almost
yeah. The same story.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I know
Edgar
Cayce.
Because
didn't he, he channeled too, right?
Unchanneled,
but.
Yeah,
he went to trance,
right?
Yeah,
yeah.
I learned Edgar Cayce. Yes. Yeah. What were his years? Do you know? Years, I'm sorry.
Oh, yes.
What,
he was,
years? What were his years? I'm sorry.
He was born
1900s,
early 1900s, and he died at
1950s. Yeah, yeah. It was kind of at Ernest Holmes' times.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tommy?
Hello. My brother's 33. He works at the Pentagon. He's a Marine, went through the Naval Academy. He was in severe pain in May, went to the hospital, military hospital, in excruciating pain. They sent him home with 3 months worth of opioids. He's like, I'm not gonna do this. He went to 4 more medical VA hospitals within a week, 4 different ones. They didn't check anything. Back in 2009, he went to a military hospital. They checked his blood work. They said, this is the worst blood work we've ever seen on a live human. So then he went to Walter Reed Hospital as the 6th attempt, and they were gonna send him home. And he said, you will find out what's going on or I'm not leaving here. So then 2 days later, they have him in a cancer unit doing chemotherapy 5 days a week, 2 weeks off, 5 days a week, 2 days, 2 weeks off, 5 days a week, 2 weeks off. Came down, I was lucky enough to find a Lilia Byram out of Lahaina. She's an intuitive healer. She tuned into his body 3 months ago. She said it was shame, blame, and self-betrayal at the deepest level, stage 4 bone cancer. Lucky enough, I know Howard Wills up in Princeville. My brother didn't call him, which is his journey. He didn't call him again, which is his journey. And then I asked Howard to help him. I feel if it wasn't for Howard and all the prayers that came into my brother Chris's heart that opened him up to gratitude and slowed down his mind, that they would be handing my mom a folded flag by April of next year. It's interesting, Miss Dr. Quimby has the same birthday as my grandma who passed away 13 months ago at the age of 96. That book, You Can Heal Your Life by Louise Hay, if you read that book, you will know more than 95% of the doctors in America that are AMA certified. We need a separate entity known as the American Healing Association, because healing is from the heart. Mind is very powerful. You're not going to heal your body without healing your mind, but you have to work from an appreciation. Most people don't appreciate pain. They don't appreciate disease. When you work from the highest levels of God's mind, combined with the highest heart of God's mind, all dis-ease disappears. It's pure perfection. When you get involved with the ego and the unopened heart, that's where you get darker and darker and darker, but you rebound over time by breaking through all the negativity of the challenges of life called blame, shame, I'm not good enough, gear, fear, guilt, criticism, resentment. Dr. Louise Hay says that, well, she should be a doctor, but she says that resentment can erase cancer. And that criticism, if you look at that book, Alzheimer's is a certain thing, Parkinson's the desire to control everything. Every major disease in that book shows a probable cause and the way to move out of that, because most people focus on the problem, turn 180 degrees, and focus on the solution. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to be doing this in the spring, I believe. Thank you. Yeah. Well, she is. She's a new thought hero. Yes.
So just a question.
Okay, and then we're going to have to close.
So is there any such thing?
Is there any such thing as a healer? I mean, because people will say, oh, I went to the healer, and then they did. You know, is there a thing of the healer? I mean, you know, that would be my question. Not that people do not assist, because that's what I do as a practitioner. I assist in the healing. But at the end of the day, I'm wondering if there is any such thing as the healer. Like, they healed me. Like, the people have said,
well,
I'm be healed.
Well, the person has to accept to be healed.
Right.
Right, you heal yourself. What is
through, and we direct and help and assist.
Right.
Right.
So
there's a TV show now called The Healer. Have you seen it?
No.
It's wonderful. It's on TLC.
Cool. Good.
He's from Australia, and he just has that gift, and he's going around for free, and he's healing you.
That's right.
And then they follow up with you.
Yeah. Well, there's lots of healers, but eventually it has to come through us. Right? I mean, people go to John of God, people go to, you know, Miracle Intuitives, people go to clairvoyance, they go to their priest, they go to the practitioner, but eventually, if anybody is a real, true healer, they know that it's the person that's doing the healing, right? The God within, power within that person. So, that perfect place that's never been touched by anything that we talk about, that is perfect, whole, and complete, yes.
I've said that they can do the healing of people that have that ability, but it comes back and they don't change the way they think.
That is very true. If you want a permanent healing, you have to find the cause and rip it out and replace it with the truth. It's true, change. Yeah. I mean, we talked about Anita Marjoni. A couple of weeks ago, she's a perfect example of this, because when she was in that coma state, she realized the truth about herself, and that she was loved, and that she had been living her whole life, you know, as a people pleaser, and all this stuff, and all that guilt, and everything that Tommy was talking about, and she went through a transformation, and that coma came out, and all the tumors went away in a three-week period, because they were being caused by all of that. It's deep, it's good. And I want to close with that first thing that we listened to, if I can get it back. And then I want to do a closing treatment, okay? And,
Rita, can I just make a guess what you guys think about what's going on? Just something about this series that we're doing? Because you know I can't stand up to be up here. but before she closes this out beautifully, this series was meant to be just, I mean, when I did it last time, it was an hour, and it was very rushed in faith. We were talking about it, that it's like the only thing that needed more was more time. So what we're trying to do is give a taste of these people that have led us, and we're going to do Louise Hay and all of these people, but we need to have a taste of where we come from. And I think that's what's been lacking in the community with religious science, because we kind of came in, and then you don't know really where the backbone of what we do here. And I think it's important, and I'm glad that we're doing this series, to let people know that we just didn't arrive on an island and say, by the way, we just have this really great idea of positivity, and we're the positivity center. There's a lot more to it than that, as we can see where we come from. And all of us, we should be proud of that, where we come from, and that is spirit. We'll be talking about it this Sunday. So, just a couple announcements. Next Tuesday is the caroling. Here. Yeah. So sign up out there. And just put on...
It's at our house, right? But you don't get to know the address until you put your name on the thing. It's very secretive. So anyway, we're going to be doing that. There's a lot of events coming up, so please, please enjoy them. And just know, and we did put out a donation box tonight because it really helps us to continue to do the kind of things that we are doing. And can we give it up for you? I know you have so much material. Thank you.
Thank you. I hope I piqued your interest and now you can go home and read about him. All right, you can look him up on the internet. Some of his works are on there and everything. So let's close out with this and I'll do a treatment. And it's the thing we listen to at the very beginning because I think it's so beautiful. So staying in this place right here and right now, this place of infinite knowing, infinite power, infinite light, infinite energy, that is all that there is. It has nothing to do with anything but good and love and peace and abundance and health. That is the place in which I live and move and have my being. I call it God. I call it Source, I call it life itself. And I know that there is only one life, and that life is perfect. And that life is my life now, and the life of each and every person in this room. And what I know and claim from this time that we have spent together is that each of us took exactly what it is that we needed and required from this evening together. Something that will assist us as we expand, as we grow, as we become even more of what we already are, which is that perfect, perfect embodiment of spirit, of God, of light, of love. So I know that it is good and that everything that is required that we need is here, right where we are. We go no further. It is right here. God is good. Light is God. God is light. God is love. And that is who we are. So I give great thanks for this man called Phineas Quimby, who enlightened the world at his time and continues to enlighten it through others. And that one spirit, that one power is in all of us, that same spirit and power that was in him and all the great teachers and mystics and leaders. And I know that that same power is in us and that we get to use it in any way that we want. And I know that we use it for good. So the planet is already healed. And we can walk in that knowing right here and right now as we walk from here and as we live it in our own lives. So I just bless it, bless this night, and give great thanks for everybody here and for all this that has transpired, knowing that it is good. As I take my word, as I release it into law, knowing that it is done perfectly
as we affirm together. And so it is.
Thank you, everybody.